correctly mentioned, an export-focused the policy initiatives taking place in 1976, when the first advance license was introduced. That was for incidental exporters. That would mean, if you have an export order, okay, I will fulfill. If not, domestic market. It was 1981 when we thought about we need to have a focused export-oriented policy. See, EOU scheme, is called export-oriented scheme, was therefore brought in 1981. At that point of time, the whole objective was, we need to have a long-term export strategy. That can be done only if you have a five-year window with you. So in the EOU scheme was, basically, if you make a business plan for 5 years, then you don't have to go back to the government for on ad hoc basis for all the advance licenses and duty drawback and so forth. Then the whole objective was, what is the capital equipment required? What is the raw material required? What is the consumable required? Packing material required? You have to give a five-year plan. And in five-year block, you can utilize, without having a license, you can import, consume, and export, and give the return. So the indirect tax benefits was given forefront for your five-year plan. Even today, it is available. In the year 2010, the direct tax benefit, that is income tax benefit, have been done away because of the WTO pressure on us. So today, even an EOU really enjoy the indirect tax exemption on all the raw material, component, consumable, even capital goods, but not for infrastructure. It is not a location specific. You can have a standalone. If you have a setup, even one building, one floor, you want to convert that to be a bond and as EOU, it is possible for you. So you enter the premises in one portion, carve out, and say, this I want to be an EOU. And the best part of that, it is not physically controlled by anybody. Your control is based on documentation you prefer. And you prepare. The trust is imposed on you by the government on the receipt, consumption, and the closing stock, and terms of distribution. So even today, then the earlier we talked about 100% EOU, then we found that the capacity will be underutilized if we focus only exports. Therefore, government at that time said, okay, so long as you are exporting the goods, 50% of the whatever the export figure, the value, FOB value term, you can sell in the domestic market. So you'll be utilizing this, the imported capital equipment for even domestic supplies is allowed. Today, we have gone further down. It says now, you don't forget about the capital goods you can utilize. And in the raw material, if you have used a composition of the raw material or inventory, from there, if you draw something from there and you produce and sell in the market, you do to pay only the duty foregone on the proportionate quantity of the inputs used by you. So this is the change in the EOU scheme. It was in the year 2000, under the Customs Act, Chapter 10, we thought, the first term called Special Economic Zone was introduced. It was under Chapter 10 of Customs Act, and basically addressing the customs and excise matter. That did not grow. In 1964, the first Kandla Free Trade Zone was called Free Trade Zone, 1974 SEEPS, and later 1980 in Noida, like that. There are about 87, the government sponsored, and 11 state government sponsored, and one private, the Diamond Plaza in Surat. 18 SEZs, what in various names, Free Zone, Export Processing Zone, and all those names came in the year 2003. In the year 2003, we found that the total in all 18 SEZs, total investment made was only 4,093 crores. The employment generation was 1,34,300. The export was 22,840 crores. Then we found that it is not working properly. Reason being, we expect the government fund to create infrastructure. Why don't we open it up? In 2003, we started discussing that. In 2005, May 1st, we first enacted a comprehensive act called SZAC. That is basically not only indirect taxation. We got the state government as a stakeholder. We made them to a party to it. And he said, let us create the economic zones for the, not only for export, and also for the development of the zone area. In 2005, when we enacted, 2006, 10th February, we got the SZAC rules in place. And since then, if you look at today, the investment is almost 4,95,000 crores in SEZ. SEZ, 4,093 in 40 years' time. 1,34,200 people was directly employed in the year 2003. Today it is 19,85,000 people directly employed, and four times of that in direct employment. I'm not counting the fabricator, I'm not counting masons, I'm not counting carpenters, I'm not counting the tile fitters, I'm not talking about the electricians, nothing that. What I am trying to say, vendor and also the suppliers and also contract laborers working in the free zones is almost 19,85,000 people, and four times of that is the indirect employment.
Okay.
19,85,000 people draw salary from assets, and the exports, 22,840 crores was the, the figure in the year 2005. Today, it is all of 76,000 crores in the total exports contributed by the SEZ. When you look at the SEZ, there are two sectors. One is called manufacturing, another is called the services. The 54% of the revenue come from in our service sector. The 46% come from the manufacturing sector. Out of the 46, is almost 18% come from the the petroleum, Jamnagar. And it is actually sector specific or the location specific. Now, we cannot really, adopt an excessive policy elsewhere. If you look at 1976, when we got advanced license introduced, we have taken the, concept from the Korea and Taiwan and elsewhere else. But in this, when you talk about a free zone, the first we all remember China. We cannot have a China policy in India, mainly because we have three-tier governance in this country. We have almost, at that time, 29 states, different legislative power given to them, and we cannot have a landmass of that type. We have a coastal security system. There are many things. Therefore, then we thought that we need to have certain modified provision. So we thought if you have multi-product, that means you can have any, even engineering, plastic, chemical, anything, pharma, anything on that. If somebody is having a land of 1,000 hectares, 2,500 acres land, you can have carve out an area. It should be contiguous. It should be free of the ecological fragile, and it should not be disrupted by any roads or highways, and it should not be a cultivatable land. It should be barren land, but not really in a major economy. The agriculture activity should not be there. Also conditions. Then we found that there are not we have almost 18 multi-product SEZs introduced, notified the country. But it's not taking off because they don't get people. Then we found that many people really started the complaining on the land grabbing on this issue. If you look at the SEZ policy, there is no word of the land acquisition. Only says, if you have a land, you apply for it. Don't have a land, you don't get it. So certain people will say, I have a potential. So I would like to explore. Then you can make an application without a land. Then that called in principle approval given to you. Then after that, if you have a land, come back to the, formalize the policies. The, because of the pressure on the land, and we feel that by, indirect pressure through various system, the agricultural land is getting into SEZ. Therefore, we said, okay, let us review it to a 500 hectares of land for multi-product. And the sector-specific, what you talked about, except the biotechnology, except the, gem and jewelry and the conventional energy, all those, if you leave that, all other thing was 100 hectares of land. Now they have been reduced to 50 hectares of land. So now, for biotechnology, it should be, 25 hectares. That means 10 hectares of land. Then we look at it. The 54% revenue come from IT and the services. IT, yes. He said, you know, we have been traveling all over the world. We found that even USA, even a standalone building can be converted to an SEZ. Why not we follow in India? Therefore, we decided that let us look at India and see whether we can classify the cities A-class city, B-class city, C-class city. If A-class city, if you have a built-up space of 1 lakh square meter, that means around 10 lakh square feet, in whatever the area you have, then you can have an ITITS SEZ. In B-class, 50,000 square meter, that means around 5 lakh square feet. If you have, you can even one building, two building, three building, convert to SEZ. And in the, you know, the semi urban area, C-class, 25,000 square, the square meter, 2,50,000 square feet, you can have then, you know, SEZ. The whole purpose is that we try to stop the migration of people from the rural to the semi-urban, urban, because if you are able to provide a 2,50,000 square meter in a rural or semi-urban area, probably, you know, maybe the professional come together, they can get an SEZ there. Because infrastructure required, there is not much. Then you must be, you know, aware. Many people have, you know, denotified SEZ. There are hue and cry. The reason being, the moment we started talking about SEZ, people felt it is a good opportunity for the real estate business. Because you have a non-processing area, you can create a social infrastructure, and that comes first, and we are able to sell it. Probably we can make money, then we develop the processing area. So in order to avoid that, after 2010, approximately 2010, we changed the format of the SEZ for ITITS. He said, any developer who's creating an SEZ for ITITS should have the capacity to design and to offer plug-and-play operations. That means you should create all the basic infrastructure by the developer himself. So many industrial development corporations of the state government who converted their industrial development projects into SEZ and started, you know, the denotifying and getting out of the system, yeah, because they don't have the expertise.
Okay, thank
people
you.
Like in Wipro, in Infosys, those people who they came forward say now we would like to have our own SEZs. Basically the difference between EOU and SEZ is EOU does not get any subsidy on creation of infrastructure, whereas in SEZ even the building, cement, steel, aluminium, tiles, anything, everything required for creating the infrastructure is out and out duty free from customs as well as GST, and the units which is coming up, all the capital equipment, raw material, equipment, consumable is duty free, and they are enjoying the duty, you know, income tax benefit. Even today, the SEZ developer can enjoy the benefit of a 10-year block out of 15 years of your choice, and you can have it. And you can enjoy the benefit because that's a subsidy on the investment. And for the units which is coming, the export profits are exempt for 5 years, 100%, 5 year, 50%, next 5 year, 50% provided, benefit was brought back for the reinvestment for the activity. So EOU still exists, yes, it still exists. Now only one thing I want to talk about, FTWZ. The FTWZ was the originally planned where we want to have a port-based a zone where we can get in CKD condition many things from the third world, bring it here, assemble and export and foreign exchange. Now that concept has further expanded to say just in time, the inventory management can be achieved through the FTWZ. You can import, don't pay the duty, take it, as and when you take it out, they pay duty and take it. And you can even help the domestic industry for the inventory management efficiently. You can also use it for transit exports. That means a third world, you can import something from Southeast Asia, label it or assemble or whatever you want. Very simple. The manufacture has been defined in a very lucidly for FTWZ. You can repack, relabel and export back. Therefore, the FTWZ is also one of the successful venture, and this is what I thought I will do.